everybody. I am very fortunate today to talk to Yannis Stavrikakis about Greece and left-wing populism in Greece with regards to Syriza. We're kind of basing this off of his article, Left-Wing Populism in the European Periphery, the Case of Syriza, which was published in the Journal of Political Ideologies in 2014. And I'm going to pass it over to you and ask you to say hi and introduce your co-author as well, because I would butcher his name. So,
hi, I'm very happy to be here and have this discussion with you. The co-author is Giorgos Katsambekis. He was at that point, he was a PhD student of mine. He was completing his thesis and we were involved together in a research project, Populismus, which still you can go to the website and see the working papers and other stuff. We did this paper together. And Giorgos is currently lecturing in the UK at the University of Loughborough. I'm a professor in Thessaloniki, yeah, in the University of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki.
Yeah, and both of you are obviously Greek, so this is close to home. So what's the background on this piece? Why did you write this?
I think that there was a multiplicity of reasons that made us decide we want to write this. One of them was, let's say, theoretical. It had to do with populism research and the direction populism research is following. So we wanted to show that from a discursive perspective, from the point of view of discourse theory, you can, because at that point there were very few concrete, analysis, case studies using this discursive perspective. So we wanted to produce one of them. So this was one reason. The other reason was that we wanted to show that the populism is not a wholly negative phenomenon, as was the accepted wisdom, at least within Europe at that time. And we wanted to show that you can have left-wing populism and, within Europe, in a European country. And it was not only Greece, it was also Spain with Podemos, it was the Mélenchon in France. There were, especially the Southern Europe, there were a few left-wing populist projects, and wanted to highlight one of them. And the other reason was that at that point, if you remember, it was just after the crisis, which internationally started, I don't know, in 2008, let's say. Greece was hit very hard after 2010, maybe. So this was published in 2014. It was precisely when the economic crisis had morphed into a crisis of representation. The old party system was collapsing. And suddenly, because usually when you have such a crisis, suddenly either a newcomer, a new party like Podemos in Spain, or an old fringe party that was in the periphery of the political of the party system, like Syriza, who would get 3-4% of the vote, is catapulted into a central position and assumes the representation of larger sections of the electorate. And that was the case. So nobody really knew anything about Syriza internationally. And we wanted to say a few things, you know, where does it come from? How did it become populist? How political antagonism is being played out in the Greek crisis, post-crisis context. So that was the empirical, let's say, side of this decision. And all that made us write this paper.
Yeah, very cool. So let me tell you why I really like this paper. I like this paper because Europeans, especially if they're not neck deep in the research on populism, they're often quite puzzled by leftist populism in general. And if you want to throw a monkey wrench into somebody's thinking about populism, all you need to do is say, what about Hugo Chavez? And that usually clicks, like, oh yeah, what about Hugo Chavez? But something, but they don't see this in the European context. And you very beautifully lay it out, even vis-a-vis the Latin American context of how this works. And also, I mean, obviously your background is in the discourse analytic tradition, and it gives a very, very nice introduction to the discourse analytic tradition. So you know, with this in mind, let's talk about it. Nothing about populism can be done still today without a definition and a redefinition and to establish where we're coming from. So how would you define populism in the context of this paper and your own thinking about it?
I think we would probably, I mean, if I can relate my point of view to this discussion about minimal criteria, you know, what could be, because obviously, and this is a problem with popular research, we all tend to work with issues and with cases that are very close to us. They are about which we feel very strongly, and we are either against or maybe in favor, I don't know. And this is a problem, I think, because we tend to over-identify with the topic and with a particular dimension, a particular orientation towards the topic.
I am certainly for more comparative. Let's take a step back and do more comparison. This is kind of the school of thought that I've been representing. So go on.
I agree with you absolutely. It's a very important issue. To encourage comparative research. And you mentioned Latin America, which is very interesting. The US is very interesting because it has a very complex history. It starts with a very egalitarian, progressive type of populism in the 1890s already, which is short-lived, but it influences a lot Roosevelt's New Deal, progressive movements later on. And then it ends up with Trump. So you have a very... you have a very interesting and very complex history, and we have to be so a comparative perspective, a historical depth. There is a long history that most of us, even populism researchers, are not very much aware. You know, we have to go back, and also conceptual reflexivity. You know, there are different uses of the term. There are different associations, there are different ideological articulations, and we have to be aware of that. And I think a big problem, especially for European research, is this very Eurocentric idea that, of course, we know what populism is. It's definitely something very bad. It's definitely exclusively associated with the extreme right, with the far right, and so on and so forth. I think this is a problem. It reveals a very short, you know, it reveals both arrogance and ignorance. It reveals an ignorance of this long history and the very complex history and the different uses and so on and so forth, and also some sort of arrogance, because there is some idea that only in Europe we know what the real solution to this is and everybody else doesn't, which is something from which I would like to distance myself, actually. So I think if we employ such a minimal criteria approach to the issue of definition, I think we would end up, and I think there is a consensus not only within discourse theory, but also with ideational approaches and with Margaret Canavan's work towards the, not in the book, but in her, this paper published in Political Studies later on. So she almost adopts the same definition, which would highlight two main criteria. The first is people-centrism, that is to say that the people, they signify the people or some sort of similar association, is considered primary for politics, and the interests of the people, the rights of the people have to be defended, popular sovereignty, and so on and so forth. So this would be the one criterion, but of course this alone would qualify everybody as a populist maybe. So you need something else also. And the second criterion we would probably employ is anti-elitism, that is to say that this defense of the people, of popular sovereignty, it takes place within a very dichotomic, polarizing, antagonistic perspective. So you have us and them, you have the establishment up there, and you have the people in the bottom, the underdog, so to speak. You know, the 99%, the 1%, to use the imaginary of Occupy Wall Street, you know, something like that. So these would be the two main criteria, minimal criteria I would employ. And these are the criteria we employ, I think, in this paper, actually. Of course, other people would add more. So ideational perspective would add moralization. I strongly disagree with that, but this is a very long discussion. We can go into that, but I think these are the criteria on which everybody, almost everybody agrees, basically.
Yeah, it certainly is the definition that's winning out. Probably Kurt Whelan would disagree, but yes, that's definitely the definition that's winning out. So okay, well, this paper is about Syriza. Is Syriza a good example of a populist party then?
It depends what exactly we mean by that. This is a very, very good topic, actually. For example, let me make it a little bit more complex. There are parties that have, and this is a matter of double hermeneutics, the relationship between academic discourse and politics. For example, in the Spanish example, we have a group of academics, Pablo Iglesias, Inigo Errejón, that had already read Laclau and his work on populism, Chantal Mouffe, and so on and so forth. And witnessing the big mobilizations against austerity in Spain, they said, okay, this multitude needs to be organized, it needs to become a people, they need to demand things within the central political stage. We have to create a party, and so on and so on and so forth. How are we going to do that? Let us employ this particular left populist logic that Laclau and Mouffe have developed. So in this case, you also have the inspiration drawn from this particular perspective. With Syriza, it's slightly different. It's not that Syriza is not populist. It's a very classical European radical left party. They were Eurocommunist in the past and so on and so forth. They were not very much interested in, okay, there is a debate about Laclau, but I don't think that this perspective is hegemonic within Syriza. They almost drew their inspiration from a broader tradition, a longer tradition that goes back to Marx himself, I think. I think that this is very few people discuss about that. But we have now a few academic treatments of late Marx. And it seems that towards the end of his life, Marx develops a strong interest in Russian populism. He learns Russian, he studies a lot about Russia and so on and so forth. And he becomes, to a certain extent, supportive of Russian populism. So from that point onwards, you have a long tradition within the left, the popular fronts against fascism in Spain and Italy in the 30s. You have many instances in which some sort of left populist logic is employed. And I think this is where Syriza gets this inspiration. So basically what happens within the crisis, you have a lot of these popular sectors or plebeian sectors or people who were in the middle classes but have lost a lot, they lost their jobs, they lost their income and so on and so forth. And these people disidentify with the old party system. There is a huge de-alignment process. They are in search of something new. And Syriza decides to represent this interest and create this alliance, this chain of equivalence, as we would call it, and to represent these sectors at the central political stage. And this is a successful idea. They employ these two strategic, if you want, weapons, people-centrism and anti-elitism. And this becomes quite successful. They go from 3% to 30-40% almost, and they get to government in 2015. This is basically the story. So I don't think Syriza is a classic example of left populism in the sense that they were influenced by Laclau, but in a broader sense that they belong to this long tradition of left-wing politics that implicitly, unconsciously, if you want, employs this left populist logic. I think they are an example of that.
I mean, one of the things that struck me in your description was that Tsipras, who's the head of Syriza, at least as far as I know it, was historically not using the rhetorical techniques typical of populists. There was no people-centrism in his speeches, anti-elitism in his speeches. And this is very new to me personally. But then it emerges. So I think this is related to what you're describing, is that, well, maybe the origins are not there, but he becomes populist. And of course, you know, I am Hungarian, and Fidesz has gone through an incredible transformation from 1990 all the way to what they are today, going from quite radical left to quite radical right, and going from, at some point, from center left non-populist or center right non-populist to a populist radical right party. So it is on my mind very often that are these people serious? Do they mean what they say? Do they believe it? Have they evolved into thinking this, or is it just a rhetorical technique? And also, does it even matter? Because I mean, if you ask Kirk Hawkins, he says, well, we cannot read their minds, at least not yet. So we might as well just go by what they say, right?
Yes, I would agree with Kirk on that. I mean, we don't have a truth serum to make sure that we know whether something was done on purpose or it has it is really grounded on some strong conviction and so on and so forth. And maybe this is irrelevant because it doesn't really matter, because maybe you have a strong conviction and then you are not able to materialize it. And then people will say maybe there was no strong conviction in the first place, but you never know how these things evolve. And politics is always a dynamic game, so it's very difficult to ascertain what is happening. I think that what basically happened is that this was a very small party that did not employ initially a very purist strategy. It was not a hardline communist party. It was a reformed communist, reformed left-wing party, the Euro-communist tradition, and so on and so forth. But nevertheless, there was much stress on class-based issues and so on and so forth. But when this crisis of representation emerged and they realized that a lot of people are searching for a new political home, but these people are not communists. They are not, the working class maybe doesn't really speak to their interests and to their sensibilities and sensitivities and whatever. They realize that if they are going to have any chances to have a broader impact, they have to create this alliance and maybe, okay, include some of these class-based element, but then they have to create this broader political collective subject, which is the people, and that's what they did. So I think this is basically, I mean, everybody does, even if you are a traditional communist. If you go back to the history, you don't go every day to do political campaigning and you ask in the first place, are you really do you belong to the working class? Are you a white collar, blue collar? You know, you don't do that. You know, you speak to all the people. You try to attract people from all the sectors, and because otherwise there is no, and especially today that the situation is so fragmented, and it is very difficult to reach this pure working class, which maybe does not exist here in Europe. Maybe it exists in Bangladesh, I don't know where it exists. So I think this is an obvious strategy for the left, and I think they do it In most cases, they do it. I mean, it's the only thing you can do anyway. I don't think it's a question of choosing. It's an option that you have to. You do it anyway. This is the only way politics can work for them. But they definitely accepted that. They accepted this task. So they said there was a certain voluntarism there. You know, because these people. I mean, there were very few there in terms of their expertise, and because obviously, in order to govern, you also need some sort of technical expertise. You need some planning. You need some, you know, these people just became out of a party of the 3%, mostly addressed to workers. They became this political vehicle that was supposed to represent all these sectors, various sectors of the population, and create a plan to within a very difficult situation, the Eurozone and so on and so forth.
So one of the things you do in this article is Kasmude and Cristovaro Virakatpastor has this great article that actually just reread this morning because I'm teaching it tonight on inclusionary exclusionary populism. And they kind of define as, yes, left populism is Latin America and right populism is in Europe. And of course, that's like a very, very simplified version of the argument. There's much more nuance and interesting, you know, in-depth analysis there. But I mean, this case certainly defies the geographical boundaries. So would you say that, I don't want to say that they got it wrong, but okay, so where does this case fit? And where do we have to go from here?
I agree with you. I think the problem, I think that because the paper was written a few years ago, so at that point, this geographical distinction made some sense. It was not...
Yeah.
Completely, because we read it now, but now many years have passed and a lot of things have happened. So it would be a little bit unfair to go back and accuse them of. But I would agree with you.
Of course.
In essence, I would agree with you. I think the geographical association is not. I mean, now today we know that it doesn't really work like that because. You have a lot of left populist, we have mentioned two or three already, left populist projects within Europe. And you also have some projects of right-wing populism in Latin America and so on and so forth. And of course, in the US, you have both. And I don't think it makes a, does it really matter if to, you know, do we need to have this strong association with the geographical place? No, I think it depends on the political choreography, on the orientation political antagonism takes, and sometimes like a pendulum, so it goes from the left to right, from right to left, and so on and so forth. The issue is the real importance of this article is that there is not one type of populism. There are many types of populism. I would absolutely agree with that. So it's a question, if I can refer to some other work by Cass and Cristobal, it can be both a corrective or a danger for democracy. So you have many different types. You have left-wing, right-wing, inclusionary, exclusionary. And the big question is how exactly whether we can, I mean, we talked about criteria that help us identify something as populist or non-populist or anti-populist, which is another interesting idea. I think, but we also need criteria in order to be able to distinguish between right-wing populism and left-wing populism, or between inclusionary and exclusionary. And we have done some work with Benjamin Declin, who is a colleague in Brussels, but also with others. And this has created some sort of debate with Rogers Brubaker and other people who have intervened in that. How we can maybe, what are the criteria we could maybe employ in order to make this distinction between national populism or populist nationalism or right-wing populism and left-wing populism or exclusionary and inclusionary? I can say a few things very briefly about that. I think one criterion would be, we talked about the about people-centrism. The question is, if we ask, okay, somebody, we identify a particular political project that employs the people a lot, okay. So we have people-centrism, it might be populist. Yes, but what kind of populist? So we ask, okay, you talk about the people. So what is this people exactly? Who is these people? And there, usually you have two types of answers. One type of answer is to say, this sector is part of the people, this is also part of the people, this is also part of the people, and maybe immigrants, or they are also part of the people in some cases. And there you have an inclusionary scenario. So you have what Laclau would call an empty signifier. The people is almost empty. You can put, you can include anybody in that. Anybody who is against the establishment can be part of this alliance, let's say. In right-wing populism or in nationalism that incorporates some populist elements in the periphery, usually you have a different type of answer. So if you ask them, okay, what is these people you are talking about? They say, ah, the people are those who have Greek blood or Hungarian blood or, I don't know, French blood or something like that. Or race comes into play, I don't know. So you have a... it is not an empty signifier. You have a transcendental, a mythical signifier, which is supposed to provide substance and define what these people is. And there you have exclusions. You have very strong exclusions. Immigrants are excluded. I don't know, other parts of the population are excluded. So this is the first criterion, who the people are, who the people is. And the second criterion would be, whether what kind of polarization dominates. Is it the polarization which is a vertical type of polarization, up down, you know, the people in the bottom and some people, the establishment in the top, or is it fashioned along the lines of an ethnic division, in group, out group, which is more horizontal? Mm-hmm. So you can usually read that. If you read a manifesto, if you read a political discourse, something, a speech from a politician, you in most cases you can understand whether he's employing a vertical or a horizontal schema, or maybe both. Maybe you have a national populist hybrid in which they employ both. And these are the criteria we would probably put forward in order to make this distinction.
Very interesting. And you say this, I mean, this work is with Benjamin Declean, who...
Benjamin Declean, there are two or three papers on that.
Yeah, I'll be sure. I think I've read one of them, but I'll be sure to check out most of them. Benjamin has spent some time at Central European University, yeah. So I got to hang out with him a little bit. So that's nice to hear about, you know, your work together with him. I think it's a related thought, but one of the things I found like really enlightening in how you wrote it up in this paper is this notion of how the radical right answer to the elite people division is very often not let's give the power to the people, which is the populist answer, but rather let's give the power to a different elite like us and I think it was probably the best expression of this that I've read before, because I was always bothered by the proposition that all radical right is populist, which comes out in Kosmuda's work. I mean, he calls Hungary's Jobbik populist very often. I don't think they are very populist. I don't think they ever were. You call in this article the Golden Dawn populist. And then you proceed to cast a lot of doubt on that statement with this expression. So I don't know. Let's talk about this a little bit. I also think that the line is very blurry here, because Because if you look at, let's say, a party like Fidesz, they would say power to the people, this is democracy, so many people voted for us, all that. So they would pay a lot of lip service to the power to the people. But the actual end result is they are the new political elite with a lot of political and economic power. So where's the line? So is Fidesz not populist, or are they? So how do we draw that line? And are there radical right parties that are not populist?
I think that maybe I would. There is a general issue. I want to say something a little bit. Paradoxical. I think the populist canon, historically, the populist canon is left-wing and not right-wing. So if you start with Russian populism, which was socialist and populist against the Tsar, and that's why Marx was so interested in it. It was not because it was extreme right. So if we start with Russian populism, if we go to the People's Party in the US, which is an egalitarian progressive party representing small farmers and workers and so on and so forth. And then if we go to Latin American populism, and most populist phenomena, so I would put it like that a little bit provocatively. The populist canon is left-wing. It is only because we have this Eurocentric idea, and because Hofstadter associated the word populism with something very negative, and then Pierre-André Taguieff and other people associated Jean-Marie Le Pen with populism, which for me, there is an amazing book by Annick Lovald on that, about the French case. Why on earth, you have the first phase of the Front National in front of you with Jean-Marie Le Pen. And the first word that comes to your mind in order to, because at that point, nobody calls the extreme right populist. You have this phenomena, the American populist, the Russian populist, Latin America. And then suddenly people think, yes, let's call them populist. For me, this is a little bit of a mystery, how this happens and how then this becomes reified, it becomes an exclusive association, then you forget about all this left-wing canon. This remains a mystery for me. I mean, it has to be studied, it has to be, there are very few self-reflexive, or if you want, there are very few books, one has to write the intellectual history of populism research. This is completely lacking. We have to study ourselves, so to speak, to see how we ended up with these ideas and with this exclusive association and so on and so forth. So this is a general point, but this is almost irrelevant to what we are going to discuss now about the Golden Dawn, for example. Because I don't think I ever thought that Golden Dawn is populist, but I was witnessing a big discussion, both internationally and within Greece, within Greek political science and social sciences, that was initially discussing Golden Dawn as populist. So this was happening. Fortunately, nobody does that anymore. So these people were convicted as a criminal organization and so on and so forth. So they were people who employed the Führer Prinzip, you mentioned that. So it was a very hierarchical, this idea that the current elite in charge of things is totally corrupt. But we know what the people want. We instinctively can predict what the people want. And our leader, who is leading a new heroic elite, will replace this corrupt elite and everything will be fine. This is the basic idea. So you are absolutely right. There is no popular empowerment. There are no, I don't know, referendums. There are no referenda. There is nothing that brings power to the people. So from this point of view, although there are some, for example, Golden Dawn called itself popular union, something like that. So there was this lip service to the people and so on and so forth. But in reality, organizationally, ideological, you had You had this Führerprinzip organizationally. You had this idea of the Greek blood and so on and so forth as the transcendental and mythical signified behind the people. You had the horizontal type of polarization. From all these points of view, I would not call Golden Dawn populist, and I don't think that anybody calls them populist anymore, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It's difficult to say. I mean, in recent history, they've been running into some trouble with the law. I understand, but I would say the contrast could potentially be. I mean, Jobbik, of course, who I think they'd be perfectly happy with the king, as far as organizations, so the antithesis of power to the people. I mean, that might be controversial what I say, but you know that that's what I sense. But also Germany. I mean, the radical right in Germany has been called populist over and over again. And yeah, I mean, maybe they are, but I don't think it's a necessity.
No, you know something else. I don't think that there is always. I mean, in some cases, there is no way we should not approach that from an exclusively rationalist perspective. You know, ideologies, maybe sometimes they are paradoxical, sometimes they incorporate antithetical elements. There are hybrids which incorporate these antithetical rationales, and sometimes you say, okay, these are populist, and then you see something else, and oh, no, they cannot be populist really. But maybe these antithetical elements coexist somehow. It's not unheard of. It can happen in particular conjunctures, especially.
Well, yes, but that entirely goes against what we started with, is we cannot give in to these deviations if we want to make very strict comparative research. So that's my resistance to the idea that it needs to be clearly defined, and we need to be able to fit all parties either in the inside or the outside. Otherwise, the comparative research will not make sense. Of course, when you're just studying one country, that's a different story. But I think I got into populism research because I saw too much of that and not enough of the comparative empirical work. So that's my personal resistance to it. I think in principle, I don't disagree. I think it's just if the goal is good quality comparative research, then we cannot give in to that. So yeah. What about Anel? Can you say a few words about Anel?
This is one of these parties that you cannot really very easily. Yeah, I mean, Anel would be a problem for comparative research along the lines you have mentioned.
Wouldn't be the only one. So
yeah, that's true. Because it's such a hybrid. You know, you have this. It's a right wing party, obviously. There's no question about that. It is its leader was an MP for the right-wing party before, but it incorporates a lot of populist elements and a lot of nationalist elements as well. It ends up in a coalition with Syriza, which was not very likable to left-wing voters and so on and so forth. But it was the only choice they had to create a government, because it was, I mean, okay, they might have some chance to have a government with one of the other small parties, but the other small parties, the old PASOK, the center left, which belonged to the previous government, first of all, they were associated with the old political system, so Syriza did not want to have anything to do with them in the first place. And then they would put very, very tough benchmarks in order to enter into a coalition with Syriza. With Anel, it was different. It was much easier. They could find the common language, so to speak, the populist side of the equation. Of course, they would disagree on a variety of other social policies and so on and so forth. And what ended up happening was very interesting. They would keep the government together for they did this for a few years because they had this common populist agenda. But on the other hand, on the other issues they would disagree, for example, granting citizenship to immigrant children or same-sex civil unions, that were there were new legal frameworks that Syriza managed to put forward. Syriza would collaborate in the parliament to push forward these reforms with the small center-left parties. So they would govern together with ANEL, agree mm-hmm. with them on certain central issues about the economy and so on and so forth, and on all the other issues they would disagree on, they would collaborate and ANEL would be okay with that. Because this is not, I mean, one could imagine a different scenario in which a coalition partner would say, yeah, but wait a minute, you are passing this legal reform with which we disagree. No, but ANEL would accept that, and things were, and of course the breaking point was the Prespes agreement, because Syriza reached an agreement with North Macedonia and so on and so forth to resolve this issue. And this was not acceptable, and it would betray the nationalist sensibility of ANEL, and that was the end of the coalition government. This is how that makes sense. But ANEL is such a hybrid that I think incorporates certain populist elements. It's probably national populist or exclusionary populist, we would call it.
Standard European populist, I suppose.
Yeah. To a certain extent, yes. To a certain extent, yes. And we ended up with this very weird game that kept the coalition together for 2-3 years, but also allowed Syriza to... I think for Syriza was a... Okay, apart from the initial puzzlement and the uneasiness it created to many people, how did we end up governing with a national populist party, with an exclusionary populist party? On the other hand, it was the only option Syriza maybe had to push forward these reforms that they managed to institute. So this
and of course. Yeah, and of course, this coalition was the European Union's nightmare scenario at the time, and certainly the first set of actions really looked like the nightmare is going to come to life, and the monsters are going to crawl out of the nightmare and live with us in the real life, and horrible things will happen, and then none of those things happen. So in the end, I would say, despite early signals and the referendum, they agreed, and they agreed on the terms of the European Union.
I think what is important to note is that this, especially Syriza, was not anti-European per se. I mean, these people were Euro-communist in the past. I mean, they were very much in favor of the European project. Mm-hmm. Of course, they did not agree with the policies, the austerity policies the Eurozone was putting forward. But this was something that a normal social democrat would probably disagree. So they were not anti-European. It's not the classical Euroscepticist right-wing populist party and so on. So these people were, most of them were pro-European. They were just against this particular austerity policy of the Eurozone. And this, I think, mattered to a certain extent. It also mattered that, okay, they started with a very strong negotiation process with Varoufakis against these rules, the memorandum, and so on and so forth up until the referendum. But on the other hand, and this is a big issue, because for some people, accepting then a new memorandum was a betrayal, was a part of the left Syriza, and created new parties, which were not very successful though. So there was a disillusion, you know, people felt that, okay, they had believed in something that it was not possible to materialize eventually. But on the other hand, there was implicitly some sort of idea that, okay, at least we tried to change the rules of the game. Sometimes you try something, it doesn't work out. We have to move on and see what happens. Of course, in the long run, this was not enough. And I think that Syriza was penalized for that, because it promised a lot of things. And then what really materialized was much less. And you cannot sell something which is much less than what you were originally promising. So they were eventually penalized with a small delay of a few years. And now we'll see what happens.
Yeah, I mean, they're still a big player in the party system. So, I mean, you highlight in the introduction of the article that Tsipras was very heavily vilified by Western media and all that. So do you think that was fair? And maybe we can bring this back to the whole article that, you know, in the distance of, you probably wrote this like 8 years ago, distance of 8 years, how do you feel about this piece?
I'm not sure fairness is something we can really discuss. It's not so much a question of fairness, although it is more of a question of accuracy. I mean, these people, because we recount this history, I mean, these people knew almost nothing about Tsipras, and then suddenly he was one of the arch villains against the European Union. Most of this was not really accurate. Of course, if now, after all these years, you are positive or negative, or you think that this was his something positive or that was negative, or it's a mixed case. So it's a question of personal taste, and I'm not mentioning taste by mistake, because sometimes it also happens within Greece. You know, this, your view, I mean, the big discussions around Tsipras were not so much about his policy or Syriza's policy. It was mostly about whether he speaks good English or whether he went to a good university, whether, you know, and if the whole discussion is dominated by things like that, you know, it becomes, you know, the sociocultural approach of populism, the high-low culture becomes very, very important here, because you see that most of these stereotypes and most of these accusations emanate from some sort of elitist perspective. You know, you need to speak excellent English in order to be prime minister or to have graduated from a very high-class technocratic school and so on and so forth. You know, I would be a little bit skeptical about that. And this is what we are trying to do in the article, to say that most of these stereotypes were not really very relevant at the moment. And I don't think they are very relevant today, for that matter. But
it sounds like it's like antithetical entirely, because, I mean, a populist party is being attacked for not being elitist enough.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, this is interesting, because it has to, you have to think about that within the history of the left also in Greece, because in Greece there was anti-populist right, which is, it's easy to understand, but mm-hmm. there was a very strong anti-populist left as well. So there mm-hmm. were people who would say, okay, the liberals would say, you know, a Hofstadter type argument. There is only one modernization process. We have to accept what is happening. The goal is capitalist democracy, like the American model or European, North European model. Everybody protesting or saying something else or wanting to put forward some alternative should keep silent and avoid going out and so on and so forth. And then, there are some losers in the situation. What can we do? There is only one unidirectional modernization process. So that would be the liberal argument. But there was also another argument, which mm-hmm. was very similar structurally, coming from the left. You know, there is only one road to socialism. It will go through these stages. And then if you have, and Greece is a cacophony, it's an anomaly, because we have a big petty bourgeoisie. You don't have a classical class structure, and this may creates difficulties. And then you have these populists who manage to create a fuss out of that, and a proper left-wing party cannot really flourish. So you have two structurally similar arguments.
Mm-hmm.
And then something happens, like Papandreou, who gets 48% in 1981, and nobody can really realize how this has happened, because this is a complete anomaly. He doesn't belong to the first schema, but he's also neither to the second. You know, he's an asynchrony. He's an anomaly. And something similar happened with Syriza. I think. But we don't, to go back to the topic that you have introduced, I don't think we make any predictions. We avoided that in the in
no.
paper.
So makes sense.
Very difficult to go back and say, you know.
I heard often that a political scientist, by definition, is the person who will tell you what happens in politics, what will happen in politics, and then comes back afterwards to explain why it didn't happen.
Right. Yes, absolutely. There is a sequel. That's what I can definitely say. There is a sequel mm-hmm. that has to be written, which is okay. about Syriza's term in office. I mean, I have written some. There is a piece in German that has been published in a collective volume recently. There are some things that I have published, and there are also some PhD students that have. There's a Grigoris Marko, a PhD student of mine who just finished, he's a doctor now, he just finished a thesis, comparing Argentina with Greece, and it's a very detailed analysis of the Kirchner's in office in Argentina and Syriza's term in office in Greece. So there is gradual, I think some of that stuff has been published and more will appear as time goes by. So this is the sequel that we need to write, so to speak, and it will be very interesting, and it has also to account for certain failures, if you want, of this project and how it ended up with a right-wing government being reinstated. So it's a very interesting scenario, but we are working on it at the moment.
Oh, very interesting. I'm very much looking forward to it. So finally, I'm a methodologist at heart, and discourse analysis is, I would say, is pretty far from where I come from, what tradition I come from. So I probably couldn't do it justice. So could you maybe say a few words about what discourse analysis is and why people should pay attention to it and learn it and utilize the approach, and maybe give it a sales pitch?
Okay, it's a big question, obviously. It's a very important question. I think that on a very general level, we could say, and it's not only discourse analysis, it's every approach to populism that needs things we have mentioned already, this comparative perspective, historical awareness, conceptual reflexivity, and so on and so forth, the ability to work through a series of concrete empirical applications and case studies and analysis. And from this point of view, I think to adopt a discursive perspective in doing all that, of course, can be quite illuminating. That's why many young researchers and PhD students employ that. And I was surprised. I mean, I didn't even know about that. It was when we started this specialist group at the Political Studies Association in the UK that because we did this yearly workshop and series of panels in the annual conference. And I realized that there are so many people, so many young researchers employing this approach that I didn't know about, really. It was a big surprise for me. So there is something illuminating, there is something original, and I would locate that in something that for me defines the whole of the social science, of course, this stress on meaning, that human praxis is meaningful. We give it some meaning, even retroactively, but it's not meaningless. It has some meaning, and we need some method, and we need some techniques also, in order to make sure that we study this meeting in a way which is accurate, which is we can check it, we can reproduce the findings, and so on and so forth. So there are many ways, there are many different techniques you can employ there. We have tried within the context of Populismus, this research project I mentioned earlier, to combine a discursive perspective with surveys, for example, together with Andreadis, to study, for example, congruence, or to study polarization, you know, very standard political science topics. And I think there were some interesting results coming out of that. And the other thing we have tried to do, we have tried to combine it with so-called lexicometry. There's a new tradition within what is called digital humanities, mm-hmm. which basically has to do with computer-based linguistics. And this allows one to study big data, to have, I remember, to give you just to give you an example, we did an analysis within Populismus of newspaper articles, and we had, I can't remember now, originally 10,000 articles, and mm-hmm. you need some sort of coding in order to, you know, you cannot really read 10,000 articles, and so it was a combination of, some sort of qualitative method, but also some sort of lexicometric approach that would give you some sort of computerized result, in order to make sure that you can really work with such a scale. And there were some interesting results out of that. And I know that, for example, I have not done it myself, not recently at least, I could not remember that. Giorgos Katsambekis, my co-author in this article that we are discussing today, mm-hmm. he has done some work with Kirk Hawkins, and he has worked very much with this approach. But we should have him with us. He would be able to compare the two. Very. Unfortunately, I cannot really now provide this comparison in very clear terms. But it's actually something that we have found interesting, and we have. It is one of the things that we can include in these different techniques that we want to employ, and we want to create these bridges in order to facilitate populist research and take it further.
Yeah, I mean, Kirk Hawkins, you mentioned in the article, he comes from a very positivist, comparativist background, with Herb Kitchell being his mentor, and he lands on, let's look at speeches and look at them holistically, and let's try to dissect the discourse. Now we've actually produced training, like video course on how to do this, because we had such demand for it. People wanted to do this. So Bruno Castaño Silva, I say we, I didn't do anything, but Bruno Castaño Silva and Aaron Jenny have put together a course, and Aaron Jenny and I have taught together, and we've trained students, and we've just quoted U.S. governors for populism, and in fact we're going back to those digital humanities techniques you mentioned, in fact I'm teaching a course on populism now. I'm hoping to do something similar with the students there. So this is something I'm employing, but I never fully understood how what Kirk has produced, and it is, I think, very important in producing good data sets for comparative research, but I never really understood what its relationship with the discourse analytic approach is.
I think, if I can say something on that, I think there is some sort of difference, because in Laclau and Mouffe, for Laclau, Mouffe and their co-travelers, discourse, I mean, perhaps I will say something very, how can I put it? Maybe discourse was not the proper word to mm-hmm. call this thing we are talking about, because mm-hmm. Laclau had Laclau had in mind something which is beyond the speech practice distinction. So discourse for Laclau is something which incorporates both linguistic and extra-linguistic elements. So meaning is created out of practices, out of the employment of certain actions, and so on and so forth. And of course, language plays a crucial role in that, but it's not the only element included in discourse. So from this point of view, from our perspective, it's not only speech or speech patterns or lexicometry, which would be, or other techniques to study and create data sets and things like that would be the only way to study this. You would require something else, especially in order to capture, there's a whole choreography, okay? There's interpellation, there's somebody who goes in a balcony and speaks to one, Perón in Buenos Aires, addressing himself to 1 million people, but there's also, you have to study reception, you have to study the identification of these people, why these people identify with this speech, and so on. So it's a very complex issue, and it's not purely linguistic. So we are talking, but having said that, on the other hand, we end up usually, because it's very difficult to study this mm-hmm. social interaction, how are you going to study that methodologically? It's very, you have to employ, I don't know, ethnomethodology, anthropological method, something like that. But this is very difficult because most of us are political scientists, they're political theorists, things like that. So usually we end up studying texts and studying discourses. And this is where a method like Kirk Hawkins' method becomes interesting for us. So there are both continuities and discontinuities, and I don't know, in the future, I think we should encourage, there are some new PhD students who do ethnographical research on populism, and I think there is a lot of promise in that, but which would supplement this focus on discourse and this focus on speech, I think. And overall, we will end up progressively into a more comprehensive picture, hopefully.
Yeah, I very much agree. I think that's a great note to finish this off with. Thank you very much, Yannis, for joining and talking about all these topics. We went way beyond the article, and it was very interesting. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's because I talk a lot. This is the only reason this happened.
Oh, I love
and
the
also, and also and also you too. introduced very interesting questions that facilitated a very nice discussion. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.